If you tried Hibernate 6, you might have recognized the new incubating annotation. The Hibernate team introduces it to tell users about new APIs and interfaces that might still change. That's a great addition because most developers expect new APIs and features to be stable after they are part of a final release. In general, that is the case. Hibernate's APIs are incredibly stable. But not being able to change a new API after its first release makes it impossible to improve it based on user feedback. It also makes it hard to develop and release a set of interconnected features. So allowing a little more flexibility might be good for everyone involved. The new incubating annotation gives Hibernate's development team this flexibility. By annotating a configuration parameter or interface with incubating, the team warns their users that this feature might still change. Hibernate 6 release announcement stated that they, of course, aim to keep these APIs stable, but pending work on other features or user feedback might cause a few changes in the future. From now on, you should keep an eye on Hibernate's incubating report and double-check if a newly introduced feature is based on interfaces, classes, or configuration parameters annotated with incubating. If that's the case, you can still use them, but you should be aware that a future release might introduce a change that could affect your code. Hi, I'm Torben Janssen. If you want to build incredibly efficient persistent layers with Hibernate and Spring Data JPA, please subscribe and click the bell to get new videos every week. And also don't forget to like this video if you found it helpful. Hibernate 6 includes several features marked as incubating. Most of them are SPIs used to integrate Hibernate in different environments and aren't relevant for us as application developers. But there are some new features that you should know that are marked as incubating. Hibernate 6 introduces 4 configuration parameters that you can use to configure the JDBC type that Hibernate shall use to map attributes of type Boolean, your UID, duration, and instant. You can use them in your persistence.xml configuration and either set them to a numerical JDBC type code or reference the name of a constant defined in org.hibernate.type.sql types. Hibernate.type.preferred-boolean-jdbc-type sets the JDBC type code for attributes of type Boolean. By default, Hibernate gets this type mapping from the database-specific dialect. Hibernate.type.preferred-uuid-jdbc-type sets the JDBC type code for attributes of type uuid. By default, these get mapped to org.hibernate.types.sql-types-uuid, which represents the JDBC type code 3000. Hibernate.type.preferred-duration-jdbc-type sets the JDBC type code for attributes of type duration. By default, these get mapped to org.hibernate.types.sql-types.interval-second, which represents the JDBC type code 3100. Hibernate.type.preferred-instant-jdbc-type sets the JDBC type code for attributes of type instant. By default, these get mapped to org.hibernate.types.sql-types.timestamp-utc, which represents the JDBC type code 3003. Here you can see an example configuration that tells Hibernate to map attributes of type uuid to java.sql.types.char. If you use this configuration and persistent author entity that uses an attribute of type uuid as its primary key, you can see in the log output that Hibernate mapped that attribute as type char instead of uuid. The selection query and mutation query interfaces introduced in Hibernate 6.0.0 are marked as incubating. They try to improve an unfortunate design decision by the JPA specification and older Hibernate versions. Based on the JPA specification and previous Hibernate versions, all reading and modifying queries are represented by a query interface, or its stronger type version, the typed query interface. If you look at the code that uses these interfaces, you quickly recognize that reading and modifying queries are different. But that's not obvious when you look at the query interface. It defines several methods that you can only use with one type of query. Two examples are the execute update method that executes a modifying statement, and the setFirstResult and setMaxResult methods that paginate the result of a selecting statement. The new selection query and mutation query interfaces separate these responsibilities and provide much cleaner APIs. I describe both interfaces in more detail in my guide to mutation query and selection query in Hibernate 6. Don't worry, you don't need to immediately update your entire application to use the new interfaces. Hibernate 6 still supports the query and type query interfaces, and the backward compatibility requirements of the JPA specification make it unlikely that this will change. The query interface now extends the new selection query and mutation query interfaces. The following code snippet shows a simple example of a selection query. As you can see, this code snippet would look almost the same if I used the standard query interface instead. The only difference is that I'm calling the createSelectionQuery method instead of the createQuery method to create the query. The main difference only becomes visible while you are writing your code. The selectionQuery interface only defines the methods that you can use on a query that selects data. And the same is true for a mutation query interface. Using this interface, you benefit even more from the separation between read and write operations. You can use most methods defined by the query interface only on statements that select data from your database. The mutation query interface doesn't define these methods, which provides a cleaner and easier to use API. Find out more about new mutation query and selection query interfaces in my guide to mutation query and selection query in Hibernate 6. As explained in a previous article, Hibernate 5 normalizes an attribute of type zone daytime or offset daytime to a configured time zone or the local time zone of your application before it stores it without time zone information in your database. And when you read that attribute's value from the database, Hibernate adds the configured or local time zone to the timestamp. Even though this approach works fine under the right circumstances, it's error-prone and inflexible. Hibernate 6 improved the handling of zone daytime and offset daytime by introducing the time zone storage annotation. It enables you to define if you want to store your timestamp in a column that supports time zone information, store the time zone's offset in a separate database column, normalize the timestamp to UTC, or normalize the timestamp to a configured or your local time zone. If you want to learn more about Hibernate's improved mapping of zone daytime and offset daytime, check out the link in the description. The result transformer interface was deprecated in Hibernate 5. It defined the transform tuple and transform list methods, which you can implement to tell Hibernate how to map a query result to your preferred data structure. The main issue with this approach was that most transformers only had to implement one of the two methods and kept the other one empty. Due to that, these two methods made the interface unnecessarily complex and prevented us from using it as a functional interface. In Hibernate 6, the development team split the result transformer interface into the tuple transformer and list transformer interfaces. Each of them defines one of the methods previously defined by the result transformer and can be used as a functional interface. And there's good news if you used one of the result transformer implementations provided by Hibernate 5. In Hibernate 6, you can find the same transformer implementations, which now implement the tuple transformer or list transformer interfaces. I described all of this in more detail in my guide to Hibernate's result transformer, which I will link below. The embeddable instantiator is another improvement in Hibernate 6, which is marked as incubating. Based on the JPA specification, an embeddable needs to provide a no-arguments constructor. Since Hibernate 6, you can provide an embeddable instantiator instead. As you can see, implementing the embeddable instantiator interface isn't complex. The main part is the implementation of the instantiate method. In that method, you need to get the attribute values in the alphabetical order of their names and use them to instantiate and initialize your embeddable. If you want to learn more about Hibernate 6 embeddable instantiator, make sure to read my recent blog post about it. all developers using Hibernate 6 should know about the incubating annotation and the new incubation report. Hibernate's development team uses them to warn their users about APIs that might change in future releases. Introducing such an annotation is a great idea because it gives the development team more flexibility when releasing new features and adjusting them until they find a solution that solves most users' needs. But it also introduces the risk that one of the new features you just started using in your application changes and you need to adjust your code to it. We will need to see how often that happens and how severe these changes will be. Okay, that's it for today. If you want to learn more about Hibernate and JPA, you should join the Persistence Hub. It gives you access to all my video courses, including one about Hibernate performance tuning, 2 monthly Q&A calls, monthly coding challenges, a community of like-minded developers, and regular expert sessions. And if you liked today's video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe below. Bye!